Hi all, and welcome to a new class of Principle of Macroeconomics. In this class, we are going to present for the first time the business cycle theory. Now, this class represents a turning point with respect to whatever we have done up to now. So far, we have tried to understand the economy in the long run, so the determinants of the growth rate of output, the determinants of unemployment in the long run, the effect on monetary policy in the long run, then we look at an open economy. In this class, we are basically changing perspective. And what we are trying to do, we are going to try to understand the determinants of business cycle fluctuations. That is, why output fluctuates around its long-run trend. Why unemployment fluctuates around its long-run trend. And similarly, investment and consumption. We want to build a theory. What we will discover is that in order to do that, we need to introduce a completely new theory. The classical theory that economists use in order to understand the long run is not going to be sufficient in order to understand the short run. For this, we are going to introduce a new theory, the theory of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. And we are going to use this theory in order to understand business cycle fluctuations. The chapter is structured in four main parts. In the first part, we are going to discuss some facts about the business cycle to motivate our question. In the second part, we are going to introduce our theory of aggregate demand and aggregate supply in order to rationalize these fluctuations. And in particular, this second part is structured in two parts. In the first part, we are going to talk about the aggregate demand, and then we are going to talk about the aggregate supply. Now, we have been familiar with the aggregate supply, but we are going to introduce a new concept, the concept of short-run aggregate supply, that we are going to contrast to the concept of aggregate supply that we have seen so far, which is the long-run aggregate supply. Hence, we are going to conclude our chapter by discussing how can we use this theoretical framework in order to understand business cycle fluctuations. So first of all, let us use this graph in order to provide an intuition about what are we trying to accomplish in this chapter. What are we trying to understand? Now, this graph plots the real gross domestic product over time after 1950, so after the Second World War. Now, in chapter 12, what we did, we tried to understand the determinants of the GDP growth. If you want, we were trying to understand the determinant of the slope in this graph. And for that, we propose a theory that had to do with the accumulation of resources like physical capital, labor, human capital, natural resources, or technological knowledge. And we realized that the growth rate in these factors, so in these real factors, actually explain the difference in the growth rate across countries. Okay? All of these basically determine the growth rate across countries. Now, in this chapter, we are interested in something different. We are not interested in the determinants of the long run average growth rates of the country, so if you want the average slope in this graph, what we are interested in understanding is the fluctuations around this trend. So let's suppose we plot a trend here, so basically a line that passes through this line that we plotted here. What we want to understand is the deviations from this line. In particular, why there are periods of boom, represented by the white areas in this graph. These are boom periods. And why there are, on the other side, also periods denoted by these shaded areas here, that are associated instead with recessions. So we want to propose a theory, a way of rationalizing these recessions and this booms period. Over the long run, real GDP in the United States has been growing around 3% per year on average. If you want, this was the slope in the previous graph. Now, in the short run though, GDP fluctuates around this trend. In particular, there are periods of recession, represented by the gray areas in the previous graph, that represents periods of falling real incomes and rising unemployment. And at the same time, there are periods that are even worse than this recession, called depressions, that are very severe recessions, that they are very rare. Now, what we want to do is we want to understand why GDP fluctuates around these trends. So why economy alternates periods of boom with periods of recession, and sometimes even called recession. So we want a theory, a short-run economic theory of the fluctuations that are sometimes called also as business cycles. Again, let us clarify with a graph what we are trying to understand. So what I'm plotting here is the real GDP growth rate from the previous year. And this is somehow captured the deviation of the real GDP from its long-run trend. Now, let us try to give basically intuition. As you can see from this graph, the average real GDP growth rate in the United States has been around 3%. It's actually a little bit less, it's 2.5%, but more or less this one gives an idea. Now, what we are trying to understand with this graph is fluctuations around this trend. In particular, why there are periods like these shaded areas, where output is below the trend, and why instead there are periods in which output is above the trend, which are instead the white areas here. So we need a theory of these deviations of output from the trend. Let us present three main facts about economic fluctuations. And again, let us use for this real GDP. First fact. Economic fluctuations are irregular and unpredictable, to some extent. Let us look at them. First of all, what does it mean that they are irregular? As you can see, the periods from one recession to another, from one shaded areas to another, changes over time. As instance, from 1980 to 1982, there was a recession 1 year after the other. Then there was a long period, this time from 1990 up to 2001, without any recession. As you can see, the pattern between one recession and the other is very regular, as measured by the distance represented by the white areas, the areas of booms. As a result, business cycles, and in particular recessions, are difficult to predict. A second fact is that most macroeconomic quantities actually do fluctuate together. And what I'm saying is, instance, for macroeconomic quantities, I mean consumption, investment, net export, we can put even government expenditure. Okay, here I'm plotting private domestic investment. Okay, so as you can see, here I'm plotting a private domestic investment. As you can see, during period of recession, when output, if you want, the level of output is below its trend, as represented by these shaded areas, also investment is going down. Also investment is lower. So you can see here, as 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 you can see here, and as I can see here. So macroeconomic quantities like output, consumption, investment, net export, they tend to fluctuate together. Okay, here is the real GDP growth rate, the graph that we have plotted before. Here are the shaded areas, which is the periods in which real GDP growth rate is below the average long-run trend, if you want our 3% or 2.5% line. And as you can see, real GDP really could move together with consumption. Investment and consumption, they seem statistically they are correlated, they move together. And for this, we need a theory to explain that. Another fact that you might notice is that consumption covaries, so moves together with real GDP, but is a little bit smoother, its pattern. As you can see, the volatility of output, if you want, represented by the amplitude of the fluctuations of output. So the volatility of output is higher than the volatility of consumption. Consumption somehow is always reaching a lower, is smoother. This is sometimes referred to as consumption smoothing, and it's because, and the theory behind that is that consumers don't like to change too much consumption over the cycle. You know, you have preferences about consumption. You want to go to the restaurant on Saturday night, you want to go to the movies on Sunday night, and you don't like to change it much. It fluctuates over the business cycle, if you get unemployed or not, but you tend to make it persistent. Okay? Similar, basically, investment growth versus output and consumption growth. Notice differently from consumption, instead, investment is super volatile. Super, super volatile. Much more volatile than output. Notice the maximum amplitude of output is this one that we measure here, while for investment, there are huge fluctuations. And indeed, investment is investment growth or fluctuation in the investment is one of the main drivers of fluctuations in output. Okay? So, if you remember, investment accounts for a smaller part than consumption in GDP. In particular, consumption C accounts for around 60 or 70% of output, while investment accounts for something, if I remember correctly, 50% of output. So despite the fact that investment is such a small part of output, it is super volatile. And because of that, is the main driver of changes in output. A third fact is the following. Output and unemployment, again, also covary together. And in particular, unemployment is countercyclical. What do I mean by countercyclical? During periods of boom, when output goes up, existence year, from 1975 to 1980s, unemployment goes down. This is what is referred as counter cyclicality of unemployment. Okay? And similar, instead, during period of basically during recession, when output goes down, unemployment goes up in the opposite direction. Here another example. During the recent financial crisis, output went down, but unemployment went up. So unemployment is counter-cyclical. Moves together with output, but in opposite direction. So explaining this fluctuation is very difficult. And for that, we need a theory of economic fluctuation. Now, most economists, in order to make predictions about short-run fluctuations of output along its long-run trend, they use a particular theory. What is this theory? Is the theory of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. This model importantly differs from the classical economic theories of the long run in some aspects. Importantly, this model differs from the classical economic theory of the long run in some dimensions. So before jumping into the model of aggregate demand and aggregate supply, let us try to understand what is the difference between the short-run horizon versus the long-run horizon. And this one will guide you, if you want, will provide a first understanding on why we need a new theory of fluctuations of aggregate demand and aggregate supply in the short run in order to understand economic fluctuations in Let us present three main facts about economic fluctuations. First fact, economic fluctuations are irregular and unpredictable to some extent. Let us look at them. First of all, what does it mean that they are irregular? As you can see, the periods from one recession to another, from one shaded areas to another, changes over time. Existence from 1980 to 1982, there was a recession 1 year after the other. Then there was a long period, this time from 1990 up to 2001, without any recession. As you can see, the pattern between one recession and the other is very regular as measured by the distance represented by the white areas, the areas of booms. As a result, business cycles, and in particular recessions, are difficult to predict. A second fact is that most macroeconomic quantities actually do fluctuate together. For macroeconomic quantities, I mean consumption, investment, net export, we can put even government expenditure. Here I'm plotting private domestic investment. As you can see, during period of recession, when output, if you want, the level of output is below its trend, as represented by these shaded areas, also investment is going down, also investment is lower. As you can see here, 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 and as I can see here. So, macroeconomic quantities like output, consumption, investment, net export, they tend to fluctuate together. Okay, here is the real GDP growth rate, the graph that we have plotted before. Here are the shaded areas, which is the periods in which real GDP growth rate is below the average long-run trend, if you want our 3% or 2.5% line. And as you can see, real GDP really can move together with consumption. Investment and consumption, the same statistically, they are correlated, they move together. And for this, we need a theory to explain that. Another fact that you might notice is that consumption covaries, so moves together with real GDP, but it's a little bit smoother, its pattern. As you can see, the volatility of output, if you want, represented by the amplitude of the fluctuations of output. So the volatility of output is higher than the volatility of consumption. Consumption somehow is always reaching a lower, is smoother. This is sometimes referred to as consumption smoothing, and it's because, and the theory behind that is that consumers don't like to change too much consumption over the cycle. you know, you have preferences about consumption. You want to go to the restaurant Saturday night, you want to go to the movies on Sunday night, and you don't like to change it much. It fluctuates over the business cycle, if you get unemployed or not, but you tend to make it persistent. Okay? Similar, basically, investment growth versus output and consumption growth. Notice differently from consumption, instead, investment is super volatile. Super, super volatile. Much more volatile than output. Notice the maximum amplitude of output is this one that we measure here, while for investment, there are huge fluctuations. And indeed, investment is investment growth or fluctuation in the investment is one of the main drivers of fluctuations in output. Okay? So, if you remember, investment accounts for a smaller part than consumption in GDP. In particular, consumption C accounts for around 60 or 70% of output, while investment accounts for something, if I remember correctly, 50% of output. So despite the fact that investment is such a small part of output, it is super volatile. And because of that, is the main driver of changes in output. A third fact is the following. Output and unemployment, again, also covary together. And in particular, unemployment is countercyclical. What do I mean by countercyclical? During periods of boom, when output goes up, existence here, from 1975 to 1980s, unemployment goes down. This is what is referred as counter cyclicality of unemployment. Okay? And similar, instead, during period of basically during recession, when output goes down, unemployment goes up in the opposite direction. Here another example. During the recent financial crisis, output went down, but unemployment went up. So unemployment is counter-cyclical, moves together with output, but in opposite direction. So explaining this fluctuation is very difficult, and for that we need a theory of economic fluctuation. Now, most economists, in order to make predictions about short-run fluctuations of output along its long-run trend, they use a particular theory. What is this theory? Is the theory of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. Importantly, this model differs from the classical economic theory of the long run in some dimensions. So before jumping into the model of aggregate demand and aggregate supply, let us try to understand what is the difference between the short run horizon versus the long run horizon. So we need a new theory to explain short-run fluctuations. But before that, we need to understand why do we need different models for different time horizons? Why do we need a new theory for short-run fluctuations when we already have a theory of the long run? So, when economists want to make predictions, they're always careful in explaining what is the time horizon on which they are making predictions. And there are two main time horizons, the long run and the short run. Now, these time horizons are defined as the periods in which prices have particular characteristics. In particular, the definition of a long run is a time horizon in which prices are perfectly flexible. Okay? So, while the short run is an horizon in which prices are fixed or sticky. Okay? Now, to make the differences more apparent, let's suppose that in the short run the prices are fixed. And let us use our quantity theory equation in order to understand the different effect of a change in monetary policy on real variables. Now, in the long run, we know that the classical dichotomy will hold. And in particular, in the long run, money does not affect real variables like output. And this framework will actually help us understand why is this the case. Well, the reason is that in the long run, prices are flexible. Remember, the velocity in the long run is mostly fixed. So it's pretty stable in the long run. So changes in the money supply is completely absorbed by changes in prices. In the long run, output is determined by real factors like the quantity supply of physical capital, the amount of labor, natural resources, human capital, technological knowledge. All of these are the determinants of output in the long run. And the reason is that in the long run, prices are perfectly flexible and completely absorb any change in the money. Conversely, in the short run, prices are fixed. And changes in the money supply, so changes in monetary quantities, will have real effects. So the economy behaves very differently when prices are fixed. In the long run, prices are flexible. In the short run, prices are fixed. For this reason, in the long run, money does not affect real variables like GDP, unemployment, like real GDP, unemployment, real wages, so on and so forth. While in the short run, instead, money might have real effects. So there is a big departure in this chapter, chapter 20 and chapter 21, from all the previous chapters that we analyzed before. In all the previous chapter, the classical dichotomy hold. In particular, the separation of variables into two groups, real versus nominal variables, where real variables are basically variables that are determined by quantity, like real GDP or unemployment, while nominal variables are variables measured in terms of money, like nominal GDP. Okay? In the long run, therefore, output is determined completely by what we define as the long run aggregate supply. In particular, here I'm plotting output. Here I plot output in the long run, which is determined by technological knowledge, capital, labor, natural resources, human capital. And on the vertical axis, I have prices. And in this graph, the aggregate demand, which is represented by consumption plus investment plus government expenditure plus net export, determines just the prices. Now, in this quantity equation, if you want, the aggregate demand could be captured by MP, M over P. And in the long run, changes in the money only affect the prices. Changes in the aggregate demand will only affect prices. Why? Because the long-run aggregate supply is a concept we are going to introduce later, is vertical in the long run. So far, I just want to formalize a little bit
more the intuition why money affects prices and money does not affect output in the long run. So in the long run, there is neutrality of money. Changes in the money supply affect nominal but not real variables. So the $65,000 question is, what happened in the short run? Well, in the short run, prices are fixed. So in the short run, changes in nominal variables, like money, do not affect the prices, can affect, therefore, real variables, like output. So to study the short run, we are going to use a new model where prices are somehow sticky. So to study the short run, we are going to introduce a model in which prices are somewhat sticky. So if I'm going to plot again the graph that I had before, we here output prices, here I have the long run aggregate supply, this is output, which is determined in the long run by these factors. I'm putting a bar just to give you an idea that these are given in the long run. They follow some real dynamics. Well, this is the aggregate demand, represented again by consumption plus investment, government expenditure, net export. Now, in the short run, we are going to introduce a new concept of short run aggregate supply. The short-run aggregate supply is just an aggregate supply that is bent due to the fact that prices are not completely flexible. In particular, if we assume that prices are fixed, we can draw the short-run aggregate supply as an horizontal line. Notice in the two cases the difference of a change in the aggregate demand. An increase in the aggregate demand existence, let's suppose we shift the aggregate demand to the right. In the long run, the shift in the aggregate demand, what it does? Just produce a higher price. And the reason is that in the long run, prices are flexible and therefore can adjust. Conversely, in the short run, let's suppose that prices are completely fixed. Fixed is just another way of saying that prices are infinitely sticky. Well, what happens? It has completely different impact. Now the aggregate demand, what it does, has an effect on output. So in the short run, changes in the aggregate demand can generate fluctuations around the long run trend, which is given by the long run aggregate supply line here. This is an example of a boom. Let us now use a graph to formalize our theory of business cycle fluctuations, that is, the model of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. In particular, let us draw a graph that has real GDP on the horizontal axis and the price level on the vertical axis. And let us draw in this graph the aggregate demand curve and the short-run aggregate supply. Now, the model of aggregate demand and aggregate supply, what will deliver? Well, will deliver the equilibrium level of prices, P1, and the equilibrium output, real GDP, Y1. Now, the goal of the next section is to formalize this concept. In particular, what we are going to do, it is to provide a theory of the aggregate demand and a theory of the short-run aggregate supply. What do I mean by a theory? A theory of a curve, in this case a line, will be a theory of the slope and a theory of the intercept. Same thing for the short-run aggregates apply, a theory of the slope and a theory of the intercept. In particular, what we are going to do, it is to propose three theories that explain why the aggregate demand is downward sloping with respect to the prices, and three theories that explain why the short-run aggregate supply is upward sloping. Hence, we are going to determine what affects how much aggregate demand is going around in the economy. So we are going to provide a theory of the intercept of the aggregate demand. So why aggregate demand resistance is there? And not resistance here. That's an example. Same thing for the short-run aggregate supply. We are going to provide a theory of the intercept. What determines the position of the short-run aggregate supply in this graph? Let us start with the aggregate demand. The aggregate demand shows the quantity of all goods and services that are demanded in the economy at any given price level. Resistance at the price 1, so aggregate demand at the price 1, is equal to Y1. But what are the components of the aggregate demand? Well, we know what are the components of the aggregate demand. Are given by consumption at the price 1 plus the investment, the price 1 plus the net export, the price 1 plus the government expenditure at the price 1. These are the components of the aggregate demand that determines the connection between the price and the output. So first of all, we need a theory of the slope of the aggregate demand. Why the aggregate demand is downward sloping? Why, by increasing the level of prices, output goes down? And for this, we are going to simplify a little bit the analysis. We are going to assume that the government expenditure is fixed. If you want, put a bar over the government expenditure. So the only thing that depends on prices is consumption, investment, and net export. So to understand the slope of aggregate demand, we must understand how a change in price affects consumption, investment, and net export. Or more formally, we want to explain why the aggregate demand is downward sloping with respect to the price. For this, we want to understand the effect of price on consumption, the effect of price on investment, the effect of price on net export, P. And G is fixed. We are going to keep it fixed. So, because of this, there are going to be three theories that explain why the aggregate demand is downward sloping. The first theory is sometimes referred to as the wealth effect and will relate price to consumption. In particular, will tell us that consumption decreases with price. Higher price will produce lower consumption. Then a second theory is the interest rate effect, which is going to be a theory that instead will connect price with domestic investment. And an increase in price will reduce investment, according to this theory. Last but not least, the exchange rate effect. That will connect prices to net export. In particular, an increase in price will reduce net export. Let us start from the first effect, the wealth effect, that captures the effect of prices on consumption. Suppose that the level of price rises. What do you think is going to be the implication for your level of consumption? Well, if the price rises, it means that you need more dollars to buy, on average, the amount of goods and services that you want to buy. So, in another way of saying it, is that your real wealth is going to be lower. So, the amount of dollars that you have will buy fewer goods. So, people, because of this, will feel poorer. And as a result, they will consume less. So, an increase in price makes feel people poorer because every dollar now can buy less stuff and therefore consumption falls. Let us now move to the interest rate effects that capture the effect of prices on investment, particularly the negative effect on prices on investment. Suppose that the level of prices rises. Well, buying the goods and services requires more dollars now. So, in order to get these dollars, people, what they will do? Well, they will de-save. Reduce their amount of savings by selling bonds or other assets. So let us look what happened in the market of savings, of loanable funds, where there is the supply of loanable funds. Go to chapter 13 in order to have a clear understanding. So what happens in the market of loanable funds? Well, supply here of loanable funds is given by the national savings. The demand of loanable funds is given by investment plus net capital of R plus net capital of flows of R. So if the consumer de-saves, which means they reduce the amount of savings, they will reduce the national savings. So the national savings will shift to the left. What will this imply? Well, it will imply an increase in the real interest rate that will reduce the amount of investment and therefore the amount on net capital of flows through that. In particular, investment will be reduced because now it's more expensive for firms to borrow. The interest rate has gone up, so it's more expensive for firms to borrow. And net capital of flows will be reduced. Why? Because now the real interest rate, the yield on investment in the domestic country is higher. So this will attract an inflow of capitals, or if you want, we reduce the outflows of capital. So this drives up the interest rates, and as a result, investment will fall. Okay? So an increase in price will drive up the interest rate, and therefore, investment will fall. Now, I want to be precise. I'm talking here about the real interest rate, but to be more precise, this is actually the nominal interest rate. The real interest rate in the long run is determined by the marginal product of capital, but I don't want to enter that into that. What you have to think about is that if you want to borrow, the nominal interest rate is gonna be in this case higher. And in this case, I'm not gonna distinguish between I and R. Let us move to the third effect, which, if you want, capture the connection between the prices, between the level of prices and net export, the exchange rate effect. So suppose that the price rises. Now the US interest rate rises. We have seen this one in the interest rate effect, the second channel. Remember, price rise, this will make people feel poorer. In order to buy the same amount of good they have to save, they reduce the amount of savings, private savings. This will reduce the supply of loanable funds that increases the prices, in particular the interest rate. By increasing the interest rate, what it does, it will reduce investment. Okay, this was the interest rate effect. Now, what we care about here is the interest rate. Now, by increasing the interest rate, foreign investor will find more attractive to invest in your domestic economy. So, if you want, the increase in the interest rate will attract net capital inflows. Or if you want, we reduce net capital outflows. So, the higher demand for US assets will trigger a higher demand of dollars in the foreign exchange currency market. So there is going to be, if you want, an increase in the demand of dollars for investment purposes in the markets for dollar. What will happen to the dollars? Will appreciate or will depreciate? Well, the US exchange rates will appreciate. In particular, now, if before, for say every euro and dollar, the nominal exchange rate was 1, now, say, becomes 1.5. So now the dollar is appreciated, buys more of the other currency, in this example, euro. What do you think is going to be the effect on net export? Well, now exporting, if you want, is going to be more expensive. For European, it's going to be much more expensive to come to the United States. Now, for every euros, they don't get any more dollars. They get much, much less. In particular, they get 2/3 of a dollar, while before they were getting $1. So this one will reduce the export. But at the same time, also will increase the imports, because the dollar is much more powerful as higher value as a currency. As a result, we'll increase the imports. Overall, this effect will imply that net export of E equal export of E minus imports of E. Imports will go up, export will go down, and as a result, this one decreases, the net export. Importantly here, I'm mentioning and putting E, which is the real exchange rate. Well, the real exchange rate is a real variable. Here, what I want you to think about is the nominal exchange rate. Is everything is driven by changes in the nominal exchange rate. Okay, but I will not make a distinction between real and nominal. So let us summarize the effect of an increase in prices in the aggregate demand curve. So let us formalize the negative slopeness of the aggregate demand curve. Now, an increase in the level of prices reduces the quantity of goods and services for three main reasons. The first one, the wealth effect. An increase in price, what will do? Well, will make people feel poorer. So, after an increase in the prices, people will feel poorer, therefore they will reduce consumption. This one summarizes the first effect here. So an increase in price reduces consumption. The second effect is the interest rate effect. Well, interest rate effect. After an increase in price, people will feel poorer but still want to maintain some level of consumption. So what they will do? Well, they will de-save. So they will reduce their private savings. But by reducing the private savings, they will reduce the national savings. And through that, the supply of loanable funds. This one will drive up the real interest rate. When the interest rate increases, it's more expensive for firms to borrow. As a result, investment will go down. And this one, the interest rate effect, explains our second channel, which is an increase in price reduces also investment. Let us look at the third effect, which is the exchange rate effect. Well, an increase in the interest rate exchange rate effect. An increase in the interest rate, what will do? Well, will make more attractive investing in the domestic economy. So this one, if you want, will attract capital inflows from abroad, an increased net capital inflows, or if you want, a reduction in the net capital outflows. So people will want to invest in the United States. So what they will do? This will increase the demand for dollar, for speculative reasons, for investment reasons. As a result, this one will make the nominal exchange rate appreciate, which means now for $1, instead of getting, say, 1 euro, you will get, say, 1.5 euro. So this means that now it's more expensive for tourist assistance from Italy coming to the United States, or is more expensive in general to buy US goods. What does this imply? That export will go down, but at the same time it's going to be cheaper for the US citizen to go to Italy, say for a holiday, or for the US citizen to import foreign goods, which will increase the imports. So export will go down, imports will go up, and as a result, net export will go down. So the last effect, which is the exchange rate effect, implies that export will go down. The important part is which one of effect number 1, 2, or 3 is the most important. Which one do you think is the main reason why the aggregate demand is downward sloping? Well, the answer is the interest rate effect. Hi all, so far we have discussed the three theories of the slope of the aggregate demand curve, that is the wealth effect, the interest rate effect, and the exchange rate effect. Now notice that the interest rate effect is marked with this star because it's the most important theory that explains why the aggregate demand curve is downward sloping. Now, in this lecture, we are going to do something different. And in particular, we are going to try to explain the position of the aggregate demand. So, why, as instance, the aggregate demand is sitting here instead of sitting here or sitting here. So, we want a theory of the position of the aggregate demand. Now, a theory of the position of the aggregate demand can be also interpreted as a theory of the intercept of the aggregate demand. Now, the question I want to ask you is, where should I report the intercept? On the y-axis, the vertical axis, or on the horizontal axis? Well, the relevant intercept is on the horizontal axis. Because remember, the aggregate demand curve is the locus of point, or if you want, is the curve that relates the amount of goods and services demanded by the economy at any given level of prices. So P is the independent variable, while Y is the dependent variable. So we want a theory of the position of the aggregate demand. So, theory of the intercept of the aggregate demand. For doing that, let us report here the aggregate demand. So the aggregate demand curve is a curve that is telling us the amount of goods and services that are demanded at each level of prices. So is consumption P plus an investment function that depends on P, a net export function that depends on P, and a government expenditure function that I'm going to assume does not depend on P. This is an assumption, okay, if you want our first assumption that we make here. So the aggregate demand curve is a curve that relates the quantity demanded at each level of prices, where the component of the aggregate expenditure are given by the consumption function, the investment function, the net export function, and the government function. As we've seen the last time, consumption decreases with P, investment decreases with P, net export decreases with P. The first is called the wealth effect, the second is called the interest rate effect, the third is the exchange rate effect. So let us now put more structure on this problem. In particular, let us give a functional form to the consumption function, which is a function of P, the investment function, which is a function of P, and the net export function, that is a function of P. For simplicity, I'm going to assume that these functions are linear. If you want, this is our second assumption. Again, we are economists, we make assumption to make the point as simple as possible, okay? So the consumption function depends on two components. A component C that is independent on the level of prices, that if you want to correspond to the intercept, the contribution of consumption to the intercept of the aggregate demand, plus a component that depends on prices. Now, the component that depends on prices depends positively or negative on prices. Pause the video. Well, we have seen before that it depends negatively on prices, and this is because of the wealth effect. Okay? In particular, increasing prices make people feel poorer. Because of that, they consume less. So an increasing price reduces consumption. Let us repeat the same for investment. Investment function is represented by two components, in particular components of investment that is independent on the level of P, and another component that depends negatively on the level of P. And this is given by the interest rate effect, where the interest rate effect tells us that when people feel poorer because of the increase in price, they reduce savings. Private savings, national savings goes down, so the real interest rate goes up, and because of this, there is less investment in the economy. So this is captured by I. And then eventually the last component is given by net export minus P of N. In particular, since an increase in price increases the interest rates, by increasing the interest rates, what it does, the investment in the domestic economy becomes more attractive, increases net capital inflows, or if you want, decreases net capital outflows, which are equal to net export. And it was the exchange rate effect. Okay? So what I'm doing here is just to impose more structure on the consumption function, investment function, and net export function. So let us substitute these functions back, okay, in the aggregate demand. Let us do it here. So YP is equal to what? Is equal to consumption minus CP plus investment minus IP plus net export minus NP plus G, where this is equal to the consumption function, this is equal to the investment function, this is equal to the net export function. Notice what we have here, we have terms that depends on the prices, and then we have terms that do not depend on prices. So let us express our aggregate demand, which tell us the relationship between Y and P as a function of components that do not depend on P and components that depend on P. So let us group together the white terms. What we have here consumption plus investment plus net export plus government expenditure bar minus the green components, that is C plus I plus N multiplied by P. So this is an expression for the aggregate demand. Again, is a relationship between prices and output. It is downward sloping. In particular, the slope is given by slope of AD, is given by C plus I plus N, and the first component represents the intercept of aggregate demand curve. Okay? So let us report the slope of the aggregate demand curve and the intercept on the previous graph. So this slope here is given by minus C plus I plus N. What is C? C denotes the wealth effect, I is the interest rate effect, and N is the exchange rate effect. Okay? You could report it even here. Wealth effect, interest rate effect, exchange rate effect. Okay? And then eventually we have constructed a theory of the intercept of the aggregate demand. So the intercept of the aggregate demand is given by the component of consumption plus investment plus net export plus government expenditure that does not depend on P. Okay? And in particular, changes in the price will imply movements along the aggregate demand curve in this graph that reports output and prices. And changes in anything else, example C plus I, G, net export, and we will see also money. We have to see how the money supply will enter in this picture. For this one, we are going to the next chapter. We are going to discuss about it. But this we will imply, instead of a movement along, will imply a shift of the aggregate demand curve. Movement along and shift of the curve. Learn how to isolate these two effects. So now we are economists. We want to understand what is the interpretations of these factors. What is an economic interpretation of this C bar, the component of consumption that does not depend on prices? How about I bar, net export bar, and G bar? And in turn, we will realize that this component depends on other variables that are not plotted in this graph. In this graph, you have only Y and P, but net export existence depends on the exchange rate. And the exchange rate will affect this N net export bar. If you want net export bar, it's going to be a function of the exchange rate. Similar, the investment depends on the interest rate, and so on and so forth. So for this, we want an economic interpretation of C bar, I bar, net export, and government expenditure bar. And this is what we are going to do in the next slides. So let us now try to find an economic interpretation of the position of the aggregate demand curve, or if you want, of the intercept of the aggregate demand curve, if you assume that the aggregate demand curve is a line. So changes in C, in particular, will be the C bar that we have mentioned in the previous notes, could be interpreted as stock market booms or crash. In particular, a boom will push the aggregate demand to the right, while a bust will push the aggregate demand to the left. Now, another interpretation of this intercept for consumption could be preferences. How much people prefer to consume today versus tomorrow, or if you want, consumption saving trade-offs. If you prefer to consume more today, then this one will shift the aggregate demand to the right. If you prefer to consume more tomorrow, this will shift the aggregate demand to the left. Other things could be tax hikes or cuts. In particular, if the government cut taxes, you might want to consume more today. So what will happen? These cut taxes. If the government cuts taxes, this one will push the aggregate demand to the right. While if the government increases taxes, this will push aggregate demand to the left. Now, what are the instead interpretation of the position of the investment, if you want the part of investment that is independent of the prices? Well, basically, firms buy new computers, equipment, and factories, so any change in the willingness or preference of firms to buy new stuff, what will do? Well, existence during periods of boom, firms will increase investment for every level of prices, so the aggregate demand will shift to the right because of investment. During periods of bust, instead, basically firms will invest less in this type of machinery, and therefore we shift the aggregate demand to the left. Another interpretation could be expectation or about the future, optimism or pessimism, in which case you can think about basically during optimism, the aggregate demand will go to the right because of this component of investment. Pessimism will go to the left. Last but not least, changes in the interest rate or monetary policy. Now, as instance, if there is a reduction in the interest rate, you might imagine that for the same level of prices, firms want to invest more. So a decrease in the interest rate push the aggregate demand to the right because, if you want, of the component of investment that is independent price but just due to the interest rates. And conversely, if interest rate goes up, it's going to be more expensive for firms to borrow. So the aggregate demand will shift to the left. Investment tax credit or other tax incentives, what they will do, they will push the aggregate demand to the right, always because of this fixed component of I. So this fixed component of I is just, if you want, is fixed with respect to prices. But if you want, this I depends on all these factors, say A, B, C, and D. So it's a function of A, B, C, and D. Same thing for this consumption, is a function of stock markets boom and crash, preferences, here consumption today and consumption tomorrow, tax hikes or cuts. So the intercept is function of this object here. It's independent of prices, but it's function of these objects here. the A intercept for investment is function of A, B, C, and D. Here. Okay? Let's go to changes in government expenditure. If the government decides to increase the federal spending, then, as instance, during periods of war, well, this one will push the aggregate demand to the right, an increase in government expenditure assistance for defense. Are there similar things if they buy, if they build roads, schools, or any type of state or local spending? This one will push up, if you want, A and B. And B will push up this component of G here. Okay, the intercept. So we shift to the right. Changes in net export, existence during periods of boom and recession in countries that buy our export. If there is a boom in Italy, then net export in the United States will go up because there are more Italians that will come to New York as tourists, or more Italians will buy MacBook Airs or Microsoft products. So this one will shift the aggregate demand to the right. During period of recession, and again, this is boom in Italy, recession in Italy, is the opposite effect. Appreciation, depreciation resulting from international speculation in foreign exchange currency. Well, if your dollar appreciate, if there is an increase in E, and here decrease in E, if your, say, dollar appreciate, it's more expensive for Italians to come to New York, or if you want, it's more expensive for Europeans to buy US products. Because of this, there is a shift to the left of the aggregate demand. Conversely, if there is a depreciation, more Italians will want to go to New York as tourists, so the net export will go up in case of dollar depreciation. Let us now use this activity learning in order to fix ideas. In particular, what happens to the aggregate demand curve in each of the following scenarios, which is a 10-year-old investment tax credit expires, the US exchange rate falls, a fall in prices increases the real value of consumers' wealth, so consumers feel richer, state governments replace their sales taxes with new taxes on interest, dividends, and capital gains. Let us look at them in turn. If you want, pause the video, think about it, and let us look at them together. So the first thing I want you to think about when you want to understand what is the effect of a change on the aggregate demand curve is the following. Is the change in the environment captured by a shift of the aggregate demand curve, or a movement along the aggregate demand curve? And the answer to this question is actually very simple. Now, a shift of a curve or a movement along a curve depends on what are the axes in our graph. In our graph, we have output on the horizontal axis and prices on the vertical axis. Now, and this is the aggregate demand curve. Now, if the change is a change in prices, say, from P1 to P2, then of course is a movement along the curve. Conversely, if it is a shift in something that is different from prices, what I have to think about, How does this affect my intercept of the aggregate demand curve? Does it shift to the right or does it shift to the left? So change in prices will be movement along the aggregate demand curve, while everything else is going to be a shift of the aggregate demand curve. Let us start with point number A. A 10-year-old investment tax credit expires. Is it a change in price? No. So it's a shift of the curve. I already know that. Shift of AD. Now what I have to determine is what will affect. Well, this one, basically this tax credit expires, so it will reduce my investment. So it's a shift of AD to the left. Investment falls and the aggregate demand curve shifts to the left. We have a graph. This is the original aggregate demand curve, will move to the left because of I. Let's go to the second example. The US exchange rate falls. Now, exchange rates are prices, but what we mean here by prices is the prices of goods and services. The exchange rate is the basically relative price among currencies, okay? So it's not the change in prices P. So it's a shift of the ID, the aggregate demand curve. What we had to determine is a shift to the right. So it's something positive for the economy. For every price we produce, we demand more, or is something negative? Well, what happens if the exchange rate falls? Well, it's going to be cheaper for Italian to, you know, get dollars and come to New York or visit California. Or it's going to be cheaper for Italians to buy MacBook Air or Surface products. Therefore, this one will increase the net export. Okay? Export will go up, import will go down, and therefore will shift to the right the aggregate demand curve. Let us look at example number three. A fall in prices increases the real value of consumer wealth. Oh, wonderful. A fall in prices. So this is a change in prices. So this is going to be a movement along the aggregate demand curve. In particular, move assistance here from P2 to P1 because it's a fall in prices. Now, the question is that is going to be output higher or lower? Well, we already know by the wealth effect. When price go down, consumers will feel richer because of the consumer wealth effect. So they're going to consume, if you want, more. Okay, this is minus CP. If you remember, consumption of P is equal consumption minus CP. Now, here, price go down. Multiply by negative implies that people will consume more. Okay? If you want, minus C times minus 5 is equal C times 5. So a positive effect. Okay? So consumption will go up. So it's a move down along the aggregate demand curve. If you want, we move from P1 to P2, and output, if you want, or aggregate demand, will go up from Y1 to Y2 because now there is more consumption going on in this economy. Okay? Go to this component, the wealth effect. State government replaced sales taxes with new taxes on interest, dividends, and capital gains. So here, basically, is not a shift in the prices. So it's just different types of taxes. So it's a shift of the aggregate demand curve. Now what we are determining is it's going to be a shift to the left, to the right. And what is the determinants of this shift? Well, this has a mixed effect. In particular, let us look at it. So, state government replaces sales taxes with new taxes on interest, dividends, and capital gains. Who pays the sales taxes? The consumers. So by reducing basically the sales taxes, consumption, the fixed proportion of consumption will go up. C rises. But at the same time, the government still has to finance its government expenditure with other taxes. What it does, taxes interest rate, dividends, and capital gains. Okay? So because of this, people will want to invest less. If you want, the return on investment is gonna be lower. So because of this, the investment will decrease. Okay? So the aggregate demand might shift to the right or to the left, we don't know. Depends which one of these two effects, one or two, will prevail. Let us do now a clicker question. Other things the same, when the price level rises, interest rate do what? Well, this is basically asking us about the interest rate effect. So, price go up. So, people will feel poorer. So, the wealth effect will tell us that they will reduce consumption. That said, people, since they want to maintain at least some standard of consumption, they will start this saving. So, private savings as well will go down. The wealth effect reduces both consumption and private savings. At the same time, therefore, national savings will go down. So, the supply of loanable funds will go down. But if the supply of loanable funds goes down, then the interest rate rises. So, the solution could be A or B. Which means consumer will want to spend more on home building, which means consumer will want to spend less on home building. Think about it. If the interest rate is higher, do you want to borrow in order to buy or make a house? Or you will say, oh, let's wait for some time. Well, you will wait. So consumers will want to spend less on home building. If you want, investment will go down. So the solution is B. Let us now move our discussion to the aggregate supply. First of all, the aggregate supply curves capture in a graph that has output on the horizontal axis and prices on the vertical axis, the aggregate supply curve captures the goods and services that firms produce and sell at any given price level. Now, there are two concepts of aggregate supply. There is a short-run aggregate supply that is upward sloping in the short run, and then there is another concept, the one of long-run aggregate supply, that is vertical in the long run. So, short-run aggregate supply and long-run aggregate supply. Let us look at them in turn. Let us start with the economy in the long run and look at the long run aggregate supply. As before, as we did for the aggregate demand, we are first interested in the slope of the aggregate supply in the long run, and then we are interested in its position. Before entering into the definition of the long run aggregate supply, let us introduce a concept. That is the concept of the natural rate of output. This is the amount of output, or GDP, that the economy produces when the unemployment rate is at its natural rate. Or if you want, when the unemployment rate is at its long-run average. Also, this concept of natural rate of output is sometimes defined as potential output. Or full employment. Output. So, natural rate output, potential output, and full employment output, and consist of this level Yn. Now, at this stage, our question is why the long-run aggregate supply is vertical and what determines its position in this graph. So we need a theory of the slope of the long-run aggregate supply and a theory of the intercept or position. So why the long-run aggregate supply is vertical? Well, the natural rate of output is determined by the economy stock of capital, labor, human capital, and natural resources and technological knowledge. This determines the level of output. Importantly, an increase in the prices in the long run does not affect Yn. If you want, price does not enter this right-hand side here. So it does not affect the natural rate of output or the full employment level of output. This is what is sometimes referred as the classical dichotomy, which let us rewrite it here. The natural rate of output is given by this right-hand side. Velocity is constant, so changes in the money affect only the price, and the price does not affect the output. Now, at this stage, we need a theory of the position of the long-run aggregate supply curve. And in particular, why Yn is here instead of being, say, here or here. What determines the position? Well, any event that changes any of the determinants of Yn will shift the long-run aggregate supply to the left or to the right. As instance, if there is immigration, so if there is an increase in L, in the number of workers, this will cause the long-run aggregate supply to shift to the right, to be increased. Similarly, any change in any other of these components, like physical capital, human capital, natural resources, technological knowledge, will have an effect on the position of the long-run aggregate supply. Let us look at some examples of these changes. First, changes in the labor force, or if you want, the natural rate of unemployment, will affect the natural rate of output. Particular immigration will push to the right the long-run aggregate supply. Baby boomers are retired, so there are less workers in the economy. This will push to the left the long-run aggregate supply. Government policies that reduce the natural unemployment rate. And remember, for this, look at chapter 15. What could be, you know, policy that affect the minimum wage, or policy that affect unionization, policy that affect efficiency wages. These are part of the structural unemployment, which is the main determinant, if you want, unemployment in the long term, but also frictional unemployment. Anything that will make it easier for an unemployed to find a vacancy. So if we make the matching between unemployed and firms higher, this will reduce the frictional unemployment. Okay, look at chapter 15. And this, if you want, will shift to the right our long run aggregate supply. Then changes in the other factors, the physical capital or human capital. Resistance, increasing investment in factories, equipment, computers will shift to the right the long run aggregate supply. We have seen for this again chapter 13, savings equal investment, or chapter 19, savings equal investment plus net capital outflows. This will affect investment here. More people get college degrees. This what will do? Well, will increase human capital. So this one will push to the right, but in the long run. Importantly, here we are in the long run, because in the short run, the more people go to college, the less people work. So in the short run, there must be actually a decrease in output. But in the long run, we'll push the long run aggregate supply to the right. Why? Because people become more productive. Factories are destroyed by a hurricane. Well, this one will reduce capital. So we shift to the left, the long run aggregate supply. Let us go move to the last factor, that is changes in natural resources. Existence discover new mineral deposits. What we'll do? We'll push to the right the long run aggregate supply. Changing weather patterns that affect agricultural production. If it is good weather, we'll push to the right. If it is bad weather, we'll push to the left. Changes in technology, which is the last term, A, which is outside the production function, our multiplicative term, and if you want, the most important factor that explains the constant growth, GDP growth experienced by the United States. Well, productivity improvements for technological progress will push to the right the long run aggregate supply. So, importantly, over the long run, technological progress shifts the long run aggregate supply to the right. And on the other side, there is money supply, in particular growth in the money supply, shifts the aggregate demand to the right. Result, ongoing inflation and growth in output. So both output goes up, but also price go up. Notice something. Let us suppose that there is no growth in money supply. So the money supply is fixed at the level of output in 1990. Well, what will happen? Well, the long run aggregate supply go to the right. But there is no growth in money. So since there is no growth in money, the aggregate demand does not move. Keep staying where it was. So the new equilibrium will be here with a low level of prices. And the intuition is quite simple. Now, because of technological progress, or because of any change that has moved the long run aggregate supply to the right, now there are more goods going around. So there are more transactions. These transactions need more money in order to make possible this type of transactions. But if money growth does not accompany GDP growth, then there will be the same stock of money for more transactions. So which means money becomes more valuable. There will be, if you want, less money than good to buy. So the price of the good in terms of money will go down. Think about our example in class where you have 100 people, 100 goods, $100. If you double the amount of goods but you keep the money fixed, then eventually money is worth much more. It's not worth any dollar one transaction. Now it's worth half of a dollar, one transaction. So money becomes more valuable. Let us move now to the economy in the short run. Now, the short run aggregate supply curve is upward sloping, in particular over a period of 1-2 years, defined as the short run, which is a period in which, if you want, prices are sticky. They do not adjust completely well. An increase in price can actually cause an increase in output, in particular in the quantity of goods and services supplied. Now, the dichotomy between the long-run aggregate supply and the short-run aggregate supply is very useful. It's going to be our fundamental driving force of economic fluctuations. Let us see why. Now, if the aggregate supply curve is vertical, like in the long run, then shifts in the aggregate demand, given by shift in consumption, investment, government expenditure, net export, any shift in this, in the aggregate demand, will not be accompanied by a shift in output. Notice there is no change in the horizontal axis. Output is fixed at Y1, which is the natural level of output. Okay, but there is a shift in prices. In particular, if aggregate demand goes up, price go up, while if the aggregate demand goes down, price go down. So the long-run aggregate, if you want, supply, of, if you want, a theory of the economy in the long run, does not explain these fluctuations. Or technically, it will do, but only because of shifts of the long-run aggregate supply. In particular, if the long-run aggregate supply will shift to the right, then output will increase. We shift to the left, output will decrease. But things are completely different if the aggregate supply slopes up, like the short-run aggregate supply. This vertical was the long-run aggregate supply. Slopes up is the short-run aggregate supply. Now, in this case, as you can see, shifts in the aggregate demand will cause, if the aggregate demand goes up, cause output to go up. While if the aggregate demand is weak, will cause output to go down. So these shifts in the aggregate demand will actually cause short-run fluctuations. That is, fluctuations of output from the natural trend YN. This is a boom, and this is a bust. Notice, in the long run, no boom or no bust. It's just the trend. So let us proceed as we did before by first determining a theory of the slope. Of the short-run aggregate supply, and then a theory of the position, or if you want, intercept of the short-run aggregate supply. Let us first proceed with the theory of the slope and then with the theory of the position. Theory of the slope of the short-run aggregate supply. Now we have three theories of the slope of the short-run aggregate supply. In each one of these theories, there is some type of market imperfections. There is something that prevents prices to adjust. As a result, output will deviate from its natural rate when the actual price level deviates from the price level that people expected. Let us try to be more precise and formalize what we are saying here. Suppose that this is the long run aggregate supply, natural rate of output or full employment output, or output at full potential. This is the long run aggregate supply, this is output, this is prices. Then the short run aggregate supply is this curve here, and the price here is the price that people expected. When the price, the level of price, notice the vertical axis denote the level of price, all the level of prices. When the price is equal to the expected price level, the price level that people expect, so when P is equal to PE, then the short-run aggregate supply is equal to the long-run aggregate supply, which is equal to YN. We are sitting here. But when the price level deviates, in particular is higher, P high or lower, P low, then this generates deviation in the level of output. Output deviates is represented by this deviation, booms and busts. When the price is different, existence is pH, that is different from the expected level of price. All right, let us look at these theories in turn. Let us start from the first theory of the slope of the short-run aggregate supply, that is the sticky wage theory. As we mentioned before, all these theories have at the basis an imperfection. Now, the imperfection in the sticky wage theory is that nominal wages are sticky in the short run. That is, they adjust sluggishly. What does it mean? This can be due to the fact that there are labor contracts or social norms that do not allow, basically, wages to adjust very fast. Let me just give you an intuition. Think about yourself in a couple of years when you finish CU and you're going to find a firm that will give you a job. Now, what you do at this stage? Well, you write on a contract your wage, $6,000, say, dollar per month. Okay? This one is going to be in 2022. But then, once you write your wage on contract, the wage is going to be fixed for a period of time, say a couple of years, 2023, 2024. 2024, you will start renegotiating. So this is going to be your wage for the next couple of years. As a result, since wages are sticky, what firms and workers will do when they sign a wage contract, they will think about what is going to be the price level that is going to prevail in the next years. So they form expectation about the price level. Hence, they are going to use the expected price level, PE, in order to determine the wage, V, to put in the contract, to sign in the contract. How? Using the formula that you learn in principle of microeconomics, where you establish that a firms in perfect competition will set the wage equal to the marginal revenue product. where the marginal revenue product is given by the expected price times the marginal product of labor. Let us rederive this formula just to make sure that we are all on the same page. Now, let us suppose that the firm has a production function described by the following line, where here you have workers, and here is the amount of output produced by these workers. By decreasing marginal returns, the production function has this shape, this basically concave shape, that will tell us that the first worker is very productive, produces this amount of output, say 2 cookies, and the more you advance, basically in this line, the less the marginal worker is gonna produce. Say this is the marginal worker that will produce, say, from 3 to 3.1. Okay? So the marginal product of labor, what it does, it tells us how many cookies are produced by the marginal workers. In this case, this guy here. Let's suppose is the last guy hired. Say he produces 3 cookies. This example was 0.1, here I'm setting 3 cookies. So the marginal revenue product, it's the value of the marginal product produced by the worker, which is basically we had to multiply each cookie by the price at which we can sell each one of these cookies. Say $1 per cookie times 3 cookies. In total, the marginal revenue product is $3. So $3, if you want, is the marginal revenue product associated with the marginal workers. And in equilibrium, when the firm is optimizing, well, it will keep hiring workers. If you want, here are workers to be hired. Keep hiring workers up to the point where the marginal product of labor that I can plot here with respect to the workers. So the marginal product of labor, if you want, here is gonna be 2, first the first worker, and then going down, basically to 0.1 for our marginal worker, which is this guy here. That plots, if you want, the derivative of the production function with respect to the number of workers. The firm will keep hiring workers up to the point where the marginal product of labor multiplied by P, which is this curve here, which is just basically pre-multiply this curve that we had drawn here by P, is equal, so this is P times MPL, is equal to the wage. Okay, in this case, it's gonna be, this is gonna be our marginal worker, and in this case, in our example, it was $3, okay? So in this example, the marginal worker will receive, so firms and workers will sign the contract $3. Okay? Per month. In our previous example, it was $6,000. So let's use $6,000. Very expensive cookies. Okay? But so notice something. In order to determine the wage to sign inside the contract, the firm and the workers had used expectation, in particular the expected price, at which the firm is able to sell its product. So they determine in 2022 the wage based on the expected prices. So here, instead of $1, since we have three cookies, let's say $2,000. Such that this one makes $6,000 and this one makes $6,000. Okay, so the expected price was $2,000 per cookie. So in 2022, they set the wage, and the wage is gonna be the same in 2023 and 2024. Always the same wage, 6,000, 6,000, 6,000. Now, this is made on the expectation that the price is gonna be equal to $2,000 in 2023 and $2,000 in 2024. Now the question is, what if the price at which the firm will be able to sell the product in 2023 is different from the expected price in 2023? What, as instance, if the price in 2023, the realized price, the price at which the firm can actually sell the product, is different from the expected price? So let us consider the first example. Let us consider the case in which the actual realized price, the price at which the firm can actually sell the product, is higher than the expected price. What is gonna be the effect? Let us use our formula. So, in particular, let us start from the original contract. The original contract was wage equals $6,000, expected price was $2,000, marginal product of labor was, in this case, was three cookies per workers. So this gave, basically determined the wage. And from a graphical point of view, let us plot our original contract here. Basically, we have here the number of workers. Here, we have our original marginal revenue product, which is the expected price times marginal product of labor. Then here we have the wage, which is fixed, is equal in this case to $6,000. Here we have dollars on the vertical axis. And this question is asking us, what if the realized price, the right price at which the firm can sell the product and therefore creates revenue, is actually higher? So P is smaller than P, which determines that there is a shift upward of our marginal revenue product curve. Does it mean P times MPL, which is equal to $6,000, is gonna be less than P times MPL? As instance, suppose the price here is $2,000, the expected price, and the price at which you can sell is $2,300. Then this one will shift our curve to the right, P times marginal product of labor. So this one will shift to the right before the firm kept hiring workers, worker one, worker two, up to the point of our marginal workers, which was worker, if you want, here, that is determined, let us take worker star, that determines the marginal product of labor. Okay? Now we have shifting, we have been shifting the curve of the marginal revenue product to the right. Do you think now the worker is gonna hire more or less workers? pause the video. Well, the revenue now is higher. The marginal revenue product now is 2,300 times the marginal product of labor that was 3, so is 6,900. So the revenue is actually higher. But importantly, the labor cost is not. The wage, so let's suppose here we are considering price, the realized price in 2023, and this was the expected price in 2023, the wage is fixed in 2023 to basically $6,000. So the wage does not change. As a result, the firm will hire more workers. Hire more workers. So production is more profitable, so firms increase output and employment. Firms will hire more workers, and as a result, output is going to be higher. Hence, a higher realized price causes higher output. In particular, if the realized price is higher than the expected price, will cause output to be higher than the expected level of output. As a result, the short-run aggregate supply will be upward sloping. In particular, let us put it here. Consider this is the long-run level of output. Short-run aggregate supply, this is output, this is price. This was the expected price prevailing in the economy. So now we are considering, say, 1,000 firms, all they face the same problem. If you want a representative firms, if the price, the realized price in 2023 is actually higher than the expected price in 2023, then what will happen is that the firm will produce more. If you want, this is a boom. Okay, the mechanics is the one reported on top. The higher price will cause a shift in the marginal revenue product curve. It's gonna shift up, and therefore the firm is gonna hire more workers. By hiring more workers, it will reduce unemployment and at the same time will increase output. So this is an example of a real effect of a change in the price. In the long run, this will not happen because the wage would adjust. The wage will not be fixed. Remember, this is a change in the price that has nothing to do with technological reasons, like changing the productivity. So what will happen if the price will double? Also the wage will double. So the amount of workers will stay stable at the full employment level, which is YN. But since wages are sticky, so this is the stickiness assumption is crucial, then there is a real effect. Let us move to the second theory, which is the sticky price theory, particularly of the slope of the aggregate supply. Now, the imperfection in this theory is that many prices are sticky in the short run. In particular, this can be due to the fact that there are menu costs, that is the cost of adjusting the prices in the menu. As instance, cost of printing new menus. If you are a restaurant and each time you create a new menu, you have to print it. and this is costly, plus the time to require to change the price tags and etc. So you can think as this menu cost as really the cost that a restaurant to face to print a new menu each time because he has to adjust the prices. So to avoid to do it too often, what restaurants do? Well, they will form expectation about basically the price at which they can sell their product. And they will keep the price for say 1 or 2 years. So these prices are somehow sticky and depends on the expected price. Now, the question that we want to analyze now is, suppose that for some reason the Fed increases the money supply and this reason is not expected. Suppose that the Fed unexpectedly increases the money supply. Then we know in the long run, in the theory that we analyzed up to now, well, this one doesn't affect anything. Basically, we just shift the level of prices up. Okay, from here to here. As reported by the classical dichotomy. Classical dichotomy. But in the short run, firms without menu cost, so the firms that at this stage do not face menu cost, they will be able to raise the price immediately. So they will adjust immediately. So there are firms for which the increase in the money supply will determine immediately an increase in the prices. But the problem is that there are other firms that face menu cost. They face cost in adjusting their menus that will wait to raise the prices. Meanwhile, their prices will be lower with respect to the one that have changed their prices. As a result, they will have a higher demand for their products. And because of this, they will increase output and employment. As a result, if the price is higher, if you want, than the expected price, what will happen? Higher price is associated with higher level of output. So the short-term aggregate supply will slope upward. The third theory of the slope of the short-term aggregate supply has the following imperfection at the basis. In particular, firms may confuse changes in prices with changes in the relative price of their product versus their competitors. Remember, if you are a firm and you know that all the prices in the world have doubled, then what would you want to do? Well, you want to double your price as well, but you realize that you don't have to change your quantity of the good you produce. Why? Because it's not that the price of your product has increased because they like your product more. There is just more money going around in this economy. So your relative competitiveness with respect to other firms has not changed. Or to put in a different word, nominal factors does not affect the real decision of the firm. If there is more money going around, you don't have to change your production. Even if you're at the product that you sell, now you can sell at double of the price, this doesn't mean that people like it more. It's just that there is more money around. The unit of account has changed, not the relative scarceness of your product. Okay? But the firm may confuse this, might be confused. So when they see a high demand for their product, which can be just because there is more money around and etc., they don't know is because there is more money now going around in the economy, so it's a monetary factor, or they like my product more. If there is more money going around the economy, I will not do anything, I will not produce more than my good. But if the amount of money is the same, instead means that the consumers like more my product, so I have to increase my production. So if the price at which firms can sell their product is higher than the expected price, A firm sees its price rise before realizing all the price in the economy has risen. And because of this, the firm may believe, oh, it's the relative price that is rising, so my product has become more attractive. My product is more attractive to consumers. And because of this, I may want to decide to produce more and hire more people. But by producing more and hire more people, what will happen? I will deviate from the long run output level and go and produce more, reducing, if you want, unemployment. So an increase in price can cause an increase in Y, making the short run curve upward sloping. Now, what all these three theories of the slope of the short run aggregate supplies have in common? Well, they all have in common that output deviates from the long run rate, output rate, or if you want, from the natural rate of output, or the full employment output, or the full potential level of output, when the price deviates from the expected price. Let us use a formula to formalize this. Now, the level of output in the short run is equal to the long run level plus a component that depends of the deviation on the deviation of prices from the expected level of prices. That is multiplied by this A that, if you want, is informative about the stickiness. Okay, the real effect of changing prices on the short run level of output. Notice when the deviation is equal to zero, which is when the price is equal to PE, let's look here at the graph, then this component is zero, so output in the short run is equal to output in the long run. Conversely, when the price is higher, let's see here, then the output is going to be higher, say high, and when the price is lower than the expected price, the output is going to be lower. Okay, when the output is, when the price is higher, this term is positive, so you add the 2yn this component, A times parentheses P minus P. So this YH is equal to YN plus A P minus P. And when the price is lower than the expected price, yeah, this other. You have YL, okay, which is always equal to YN plus A times P minus P, but now this is negative. Well, before was positive. Okay, Y is equal output, which is the realized level of output. I call it output in the short run because this is the high frequency output we observe. This is the natural rate of output, or if you want, the full employment level of output, or the potential level of output, the output at full potential. This is the actual price level. This is the expected price level. And this A measures how much Y responds to unexpected changes in prices. Which will tell you is informative about the stickiness of the prices. So, let us see this one in the graph again. The expected price level, so let Yn be equal to the natural rate of output, P is the expected price level. Then when price is bigger than the expected price level, so the realized price the one you observe in the news, is higher than the expected price level, then there is a positive deviation of output from YN, while if output is lower, there is a negative deviation of output from the natural level of output. Importantly, these imperfections are temporary over time. In particular, sticky wages and prices become flexible in the long run, so contracts can be readjusted and menus can be reprinted. Misperceptions in the long run are corrected. In particular, you realize whether your product, if you have a higher demand because people like more your product, or it was just a monetary phenomenon, the fact that it was just a higher price due to the fact that there is more money going around. So in the long run, and this is crucial, in the long run, the price is always equal to the expected price, which is another way of saying that in the long run, there are not many mistakes, if you want, in the contracts or prices, or if you want, these mistakes average out, okay? So the level of price is equal to the expected price level. So as a result, the long run aggregate supply curve is vertical. So in the long run, PE is always equal to P, and Y is equal to YN, okay? So if you want, in the long run aggregate supply is equal to YN plus any mistakes, P minus P, but the point is that these are always zero. Let us now use the formula we derived before of the short-run aggregate supply in order to isolate, or if you want, identify the intercept. Importantly, remember that here the independent variable consists of the prices, so is the vertical axis, while the dependent variable is Y and is the horizontal axis. So the relevant intercept is gonna be on the horizontal axis. So let us derive the intercept of the short run aggregate supply. For doing that, we want to express the short run aggregate supply as a function of Y and P, where P is the independent variable and Y is the dependent variable. So let us report the short run aggregate supply formula derived before. Y output is equal to the natural rate of output plus A times deviation of the price from the expected price. So let us expand these parentheses. Remember, we want to express Y as a function of P. So let us expand the parentheses. Y n plus A times P minus A times PE. Again, I want to express everything in terms of output and prices. So let us collect the terms on the right-hand side that do not depend on the level of price. Expected price is given. Remember, it's like a constant. So we can put yn minus a times p plus a times p output. So here we have an expression that tells us the dependence of output from prices and a constant that does not depend on the level of prices. Now, this second term allow us to individuate the slope of the short-run aggregate supply, while this term denotes the intercept of the short run aggregate supply. So the slope A, I can report it in a graph, and the intercept is given by this term here, yn minus a times b. This will be the intercept of our short-run aggregate supply. So our intercept of the short-run aggregate supply depends on yn, which is the natural rate of output, or output at full potential, or the full employment level of output, and to a function AP of the expected prices. In particular, the intercept will depend positively on the level natural rate of output and negatively on the expected price. Let us see that in a graph. In particular, what are the possible determinants that may shift the short-run aggregate supply? We know that the determinants of the position are yn and pe, so let us report here our formula. Y is equal to yn minus a times p plus ap. This is the slope. This is the intercept. So what may shift the short-run aggregate supply? Two things. One, changes in yn, so in the natural rate of output, and two, changes in p. Changes in yn, and two, changes in p. Let us see an effect of a change in yn. So a change in yn captures a shift of the long-run aggregate supply. Let's consider a case where yn prime is greater than the original yn, so a shift to the right of the long-run aggregate supply. What do you think is going to be the effect on the short-run aggregate supply? Well, it's very simple. The short-run aggregate supply will just shift to the right. In particular, the expected price is going to be the same, so it will meet the long-run aggregate supply at the same expected price. But the short-run aggregate supply, so if the long-run aggregate supply shifts right, the short-run aggregate supply follows. Importantly, we meet the same level of the expected price. And in particular, the intercept now will become yn prime minus ap, which shifts to the right. Okay? Wonderful. Let us look at another example where instead there is a shift in the expected price. So yn stays fixed, the short-run aggregate supply is equal to yn minus ap. Short-run aggregate supply meets the aggregate supply when the price is equal to the expected price. Now what we want to study, what happens if there is an increase in the expected prices to p prime? What if there is a change in expected price? Well, even here, it's clear the yn does not move, the long-run aggregate supply stays fixed. In this case, what it changes is now the short-run aggregate supply will shift to the left. And in particular, it's gonna meet the long-run aggregate supply at the new level of prices. So the short-run aggregate supply will shift to the left, and this is due to the fact yn minus a, the new level of PE, will shift the intercept to the left. Okay, what is the economic interpretation? Well, if the expected price rises, then workers and firms will set higher wages. Go back to the slides where we determined that. Okay, if the worker firms set higher wages, now at each P, at each level of price, now production is less profitable. As a result, there is a reduction in output for every level of price. For every level of price, fix this level of price, there will be less production. Our final goal is the one of understanding and explaining economic fluctuations. So let us now try to use the aggregate demand and aggregate supply model in order to do that. In particular, economic fluctuations are due to shifts in the aggregate demand or in the aggregate supply curve. So in order to analyze and, if you want, explain economic fluctuation using the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model, we have to consider four main steps. The first one, we have to determine whether some event that we observe shifts the aggregate demand or the aggregate supply curve. Second, we want to determine whether the curve has shifted to the left or to the right. Then we can use the aggregate demand and aggregate supply diagram in order to see the effect on output and prices in the short run. Last but not least, we can actually study how the economy adjusts from these temporary fluctuations to the new equilibrium in the long run. For this reason, in order to study economic fluctuation, economists categorize two types of main shocks: shocks that affect the aggregate demand and shocks that affect the aggregate supply. Let us look at them in turn. Let us start with the aggregate demand shocks. Let us look at shocks that affect the aggregate demand, in particular a stock market crash. Now, this is a shock that will affect the intercept, if you want, the position of the aggregate demand. Try to think about through which components. If you want, go back to the previous slides. Well, a stock market crash will affect consumption. In particular, if there is a crash, people will feel poorer and therefore will consume less for every level of prices. So consumption will fall and the aggregate demand will shift to the left. Now, the shorter equilibrium is this new point B that has a lower level of price and a lower level of output, if you want, P2 and Y2. Now, in this new equilibrium, there is a lower level of output, Y2, than the full employment level of output. Because of this, unemployment is higher than when output is at full potential. Since unemployment is higher, this will allow firms to get workers at a cheaper wage. And in particular, workers from outside will start competing for a lower wage, and this one will create a reduction in the wage in the economy. So firms, by lowering the wage, will be able to sell the product at a lower price. Therefore, this one will create a lower expected price in the future. As a result, the short-run aggregate supply will shift to the right until the long-run equilibrium is reached at the new level of prices P3 that is associated with the full employment level of output YN. At this point, unemployment goes back to the initial level, which is the level of full employment. Now, examples in the history of big aggregate demand shocks have been represented by the Great Depression, which was from 1929 to 1933, where the money supply fell almost by 30% due to the problem in the banking system. Stock prices fell by around 90%, reducing consumption and investment. Output fell by around 30%, and price fell by around 20%. Eventually, unemployment rose from 3% to almost 25%. All of these results are consistent with our previous analysis. Another example, in this case of a positive boom, was the Second World War. Okay, this is a shift to the right of the aggregate demand curve. From 1939 to 1944, the government outlays rose from 9.1 billion to 91.3 billion, almost 10 times higher. As a result, output rose by 90%, prices rose by 20%, and unemployment fell from 20% to 1%. And this, again, we can use the aggregate demand, aggregate supply framework in order to study. So let us do now this activity in class. Draw the AD short-run aggregate supply, long-run aggregate supply diagram for the US economy starting a long-run equilibrium. Then suppose there is a boom in Canada and use your diagram in order to determine both the short-run and long-run effect on US GDP, price level, and employment of this boom in Canada. Now, there is a boom in Canada. This affects net export, so Canada will, if you want, import more goods from the United States, so the United States will export more, so the aggregate demand curve will shift to the right. As a result, now output is higher than the natural rate of output. So the short-term equilibrium is at this point B, where output is Y2, which is bigger than Yn, and the price is higher, P2, than the original level of price, P1, that consists in the old expected level of prices. Now, because of this, firms will start competing for employed. Now, unemployment is lower with respect to the unemployment rate that is associated with the natural level of output. As a result, over time, price will rise. In particular, firms will start competing for workers. There are not many workers around for hiring. So what will happen there to rise the wages? This will increase, in general, the expected prices that will shift the short-run aggregate supply to the left, causing, if you want, higher expected price in the economy, bringing about a new equilibrium, point C, with a higher level of prices, P3, but the same level of natural level of output. Let us now move to the other kinds of shocks that economy experience, that is the aggregate supply shocks. In particular, short-run aggregate supply shocks. As instance, let's suppose there is an oil price rise. An oil price rise will imply an increase in the cost that shift the short-run aggregate supply curve. And let us assume for now that the long-run aggregate supply will be constant. So this is just a temporary short-run aggregate supply shock. So this will shift the short-run aggregate supply to the left. So this will determine a new equilibrium where there is a lower level of output, Y2 is lower than the natural rate of output, but a higher level of prices, which is determined by the point B. Now, from A to B, the economy is experiencing what is sometimes referring to as stagflation, that is a period of both falling output and rising prices. If you want a period with two bad news. Now, how the economy is gonna adjust to the long-run equilibrium level? Well, that depends whether the policymaker will intervene or not. Let us start from the case where the policymaker decide not to intervene. Now, in this case, well, we are in the same situation we have studied before. Unemployment is higher than the natural rate of unemployment that you find when output is at full potential. And because of this, firms will be able to lower the wages of the workers. If you want, there is more competition among the workers. And because of this, they will be able also to reduce the price. Overall, the expected price will go down, bringing the economy back in equilibrium at the point A. Conversely, let's suppose that the policymaker decide to intervene, say by boosting government expenditure that shifts the intercept of the aggregate demand curve to the right, or by printing money, therefore using monetary policy. Now, in this case, the economy will reach a new equilibrium, which is point C, where the price, P3, is higher than the starting price before the shock, which was P1. But the employment level, or if you want, the output and the natural rate of output, is the same. Conversely, if the policymaker do not intervene, the economy just go back to the original long-run equilibrium. So if you want, compare point C with point A. Let us consider this clicker. Suppose the economy is in a long-run equilibrium. In a short span of time, there is a sharp rise in the stock market, an increase in government purchases, an increase in the money supply, and a decline in the value of the dollar. In the short run, what this one will cause? Well, let us look. Let us use our graph to study this case. Short run aggregate supply, natural rate of output, expected price, this is the price. Now, what is the shock? There is a sharp rise in the stock market. This one will increase consumption, and if you want, also investment. An increase in the government purchases, this will shift, if you want, the intercept associated with the government expenditure. An increase in the money supply, this one will affect all the components of the aggregate demand, so consumption plus investment plus government expenditure plus net export, plus a decline in the value of dollars, so now it's cheaper, if you want, for other countries to import the US good, so this one will increase net export from the United States. All of these factors, if you want, shifts the intercept of the aggregate demand curve to the right. So the aggregate demand curve, output, price, remember price is independent variables, output is the dependent variable, so the intercept is in the horizontal axis. This one will shift to the right, which will cause a higher level of prices and a higher level of output. So the solution is A, the price level and real GDP will both rise. Let us look at the effect of the oil price shock in the 1970s. This is an example of a supply, of the short-run aggregate supply shock. Long-run aggregate supply, short-run aggregate supply. The short-run aggregate supply in particular goes to the left. Point B. So what do we expect? Well, we do expect prices to go up in the short run and output to go down and unemployment to rise. Let us look. Well, real oil price in 1973-1975, so it's a short run aggregate supply shock. It lasts for 2 years. The CPI went up, so the price indeed increased, as reported in the graph below. Real GDP went down by around 1%, and the number of employed increased. Same story for the other crisis. So the aggregate demand, aggregate supply curve model, once we learn how to identify the shock, can be useful in order to make prediction about the level of prices, CPI, and the level of output. Once we identify what is the shock, which is a short-run aggregate supply shock. output and unemployment are connected together. Now, the theory for which economic fluctuations might be caused by a weak or fluctuations in the aggregate demand is due to John Maynard Keynes, the first in the General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money of 1936, argued that recession and depression can actually result from weak demand, and the policymaker actually should intervene using the aggregate demand. And this was a clear critique of the classical theory. The long run is a misleading guide to current affairs. In the long run, we are all dead.